Atma, namaste to the whole Pranik family and to everyone who will watch this, you know, this recording later on as well, because we are planning to put this up so that everyone can keep watching it and again. So it's a lovely day for all of us to actually get together and speak about love and kindness, because tomorrow is actually the 13th is World Kindness Day. And who better than to speak about it than, you know, Pranic Healers, because we do the Twin Hearts meditation all the time. And it's the meditation on, you know, loving kindness. So with that, we would like to thank all of you for spending your evening with us and being a part of this group. And whoever's going to be watching, we hope that you will enjoy the next hour, that you will enjoy and you will really, really think about how, you know, your life is and how we can make it better, right? So if you're not a Pranic Healer also, you're part of the family anyway, so don't worry. Someone went and said, I'm not a Pranic Healer, but
yes.
It's very nice to have all of you. So to everybody, a big, big hello and a good evening to all of you. So my name is Mekhla. I think some of you might know me, but definitely everybody knows Sumi, because Sumi has been, you know, one of the pillars of the Pranic Healing community. She has been, you know, somebody who all of us have also been looking up to for a while, because Sumi started, you know, doing Pranic Healing, practicing Pranic Healing in 1995. And then I think in the next year itself, she started teaching, right? Sumi, it's amazing the jump that came. Some of us were thinking about teaching, but you jumped into it. And then in, I think, 1999, you joined Grandmaster's organization. You started working for Grandmaster Chow Kok Sui. And so the relationship is really amazing, because we see the teacher as a guru, but you also knew him as a boss.
Oh, yes, he was definitely a boss. A very different relationship from being a guru or a teacher and then being a boss. But he was also like a fatherly figure for me. It was just around that time I joined September, and I lost my father in October of the same year. And so, you know, that space for me was also GMCKS. So he became a father figure. He became my boss, definitely. And because I come from a background which, you know, where you don't have gurus. So to accept Master Chua as a guru took me time. As a teacher, it was easy, you know, because you had school teachers, you had university professors. So that was easy for me. But to consider him as a spiritual guru took me some time. But for me now, he's the only spiritual guru I have.
So apart from all of this, I don't think very many people know that you have also completed a master's in counseling psychology. So I didn't know this about you, actually. And we've been friends for a while. I didn't know you've done all of this.
True. I normally don't talk about it. So basically in 99, I had to give up. I finished with my course. I did my thesis. And I was actually planning to go to the US to study. And that's when, you know, life changed for me. And I was working, when I started to work for Grandmaster Chua, as a therapist, as a group counseling therapist in a college back in Bangalore. And I was also working here. So when Dr. Sundaram called me and said, you know, would you like to join us? I said, listen, Mr. Sundaram, two things. One is I'm already working at this college as a group counselor. So I need to go there on Friday afternoons. And Saturday, Sunday, you have to give me off because I want to continue to teach. I said, if you're okay with those two conditions, I'm willing to join. And that's how it started for me, you know. But I think one of the things I love about Mr. Sundaram is he was always there to guide me in very subtle and in a very kind way. Since this is the topic of kindness, I think that is what made me stay. Because he was a person I was directly working with at that point. And a little later is when Master Chua, interestingly, the college asked me to become full-time professor. And Master Chua literally asked me, I think a couple of weeks later, he came to India and he said, Sumi, would you like to become full-time? You know, that means I had to let go of the college work that I was doing. And I was literally at the crossroads and weighed all my pros and cons and decided Grandmaster Chua, working for him would be a better choice. And so I'm still here.
So we're very glad that you made that choice, by the way. So
we're really, really, I'm glad if I look back, yes.
Yeah, because, you know, now you teach Arhatic prep in lots of different countries as well. So you've just gone from strength to strength. And what other, you know, for everyone who's watching as well, you managed to juggle all of this and also have a child, and you know, you're a mother and you are a wife, and
correct.
That's amazing, the juggling that is happening, and especially during the pandemic. You know, this is why the whole conversation started off on how can we really talk about, you know, grandmaster's teachings and how to be kind in such a stressful, you know, episode in everyone's life. So, which is why, you know, we thought that we will talk about pranic healing, we'll talk about kindness. Now, for everyone who doesn't know pranic healing, grandmaster had this statement which he made. He said that pranic healing is loving kindness in action. So pranic healing is loving kindness in action. So, you know, Sumi, if you could just, you know, expand on that, that would be great, on why he said that.
Correct. And you're right, Master Chua did say that. So if you look at us beings, we're supposed to be actually beings of love. And when you look at love, love seems to be a very easy word. You know, you just use it loosely in many scenarios. And so when Master Chua used to talk about love, he says you have to add the act. And the act of showing love and care is actually kindness. Yes. And so when you move that love that you have in your heart to act upon it, then you show that care and love and kindness to your family to begin with. Yes, you're there to take care of your little one. I mean, for me, when I had my baby, you had to wake up in the middle of the afternoon, middle of the night to take care of the needs of the child. Whether he's crying, whether he falls, you will always be there because of the love that you have. And that act to serve that child is kindness and manifests out of love, yes? And this continues with our friends. You know, we have people who are so close to us. And when you're going through a difficult time, they take that time out to be with you. Whether it's to just sit with you or listen to you, that's kindness.
You yes? know, interestingly that, you know, as a pranic healer, we do healings, we help out people, and then you forget about it. But they never forget it. And even with us, when we have been low, when someone has, you know, given you something, some encouragement or helped you out, you really, really remember that act. Yes. So the acts of kindness is just so potent that, you know, you will always remember something that happened when you were down and someone helped you, whether they knew it or not, but they helped you and their words helped you. Why is it that kindness is such a potent and strong force in someone's life? Because you will remember. So, you know, you were talking about how when you lost your father and then when you went on, you know, into pranic healing and you met Grandmaster Chua, and it must have been his very kindness that actually drew you in, because that's how you stay.
True. For me, I remember when I joined, there was a certain amount of, you know, the salary that was set by Dr. Sundaram. And I joined in September, as you mentioned. And in January, Master comes to India, right? And so at that point, he literally doubled my salary. And I remember we were at the Oberoi Hotel. We were in the lobby and I was seated there. And Shriram came and told me, this is what Master Chua has done. And I started to cry. You know, and he went back to Master, and Master's walking up and down the lobby. You know, Master never really stands. So he says, what happened? Why is she crying? Does she need more money? I was like, oh my God, is that what Master Chua thought about me? No, he says, no, Master, she's not crying because she needs more money. She's touched by what you did for her, right? And I was so touched that Master Chua actually thought I was someone who could actually receive double the salary in less than like 4 months that I started to work there. And so he's done that so many times, and his act of kindness, there were times that I couldn't travel, though he did ask me to travel with him wherever he went in India. There were times when there was a retreat in Bangalore and Shriram was traveling with Master. I knew it was not easy for him to travel and take care of it. So I would stay back to take care of the needs of the foundation. And if he bought something, right, say for the people when he was, say, in a city in Delhi, he would always remember to send something for Sumi. And so when Shriram comes back, he says, oh, by the way, Master Chua bought this for you. And those were precious moments. On his birthday, I remember once, you know, he was getting different gifts and he gave me this little Ganesha, which was a little silver thing. And I still have it on my table. My memory of Masuchoa. And for me, Ganesha is the one who removes hurdles and is also associated with prosperity. So I said, if Masuchoa has given me this, I'm keeping it. And so I have it at the table. Of course, now I'm not in front of the table because of COVID, but that is a remembrance. And then I have a clock from him, which I've kept. So yes, I do agree that these acts of kindness make a big difference. Now, even with my little son, I remember, you know, whenever he starts to cry, especially when he gets emotionally upset and I'm there to hug him. And there was this one day I got upset and I started to cry and he came and hugged me and he says, you know, Mama, just like you're always there for me, I want to be there for you. Right? So you don't realize, but it's like, you know, this little tiny hand comes around you like a big man and holds you and says, you know, it's going to be okay. I'm there for you. That's when it hits you that, you know, when you think that maybe your acts of kindness are not being noticed, there are others who are noticing it. So I agree with what you just said.
So you know, when we were talking about kindness and going by what you have said as well, kindness makes you stay with somebody. And, you know, interestingly, the science part of it, you know, when we were having this whole conversation about kindness, I decided to look up some things. And interestingly, and this came out from the Gottman Institute, they talked about one of the most important indicators of satisfaction and happiness in a marriage is actually kindness. The kindness is the glue, kindness and emotional stability. The kindness is the glue that keeps two people together. So, you know, a relationship, or it could be a relationship with your boss, it could be a relationship in your home, but the kindness acts like a glue. Now, I understand that most of us have been locked in for a while now. And, you know, we've been with our families. And even though you love them a lot, at points we've snapped, right? We've acted a little short with them at points. We've snapped a little bit, and that is not kind. So how would you explain how to be kinder in your interactions, or, you know, how do you handle this tendency, especially in the lockdown, to snap at someone you love?
I think the lockdown has been a lesson for all of us, including me. I've actually noticed that with my interactions staying so close, you know, I've always had the luxury because of Masuchoa's work to kind of take off from the family, because I had a class in some city in India or outside India. So, you know, 10 days and then I'm out and I come back. So there was always, even if feathers were ruffled, I always had that exit point to go out and, you know, calm down and come back. So things were okay. But during the lockdown, it was tough. It was tough because you were there with the same person day in and day out. You couldn't even go out of the gate for a while. And I realized, you know, that friction was starting because we're staying so close. There was no way for me to go and come back, right? So that friction caused issues. And I'm not saying I've become much better. I'm still struggling with that. But there is definitely recognition. And at the same time, you still realize, even though things were not going like it was before, that there were instances, you know, suddenly our son has online classes. You have to be there, or my husband has to be there. And you're like, you're supposed to be there. I thought you were going to be there. You know, there are things that just started to happen. And like you rightly said, it's those little moments where, you know, when he's there, I would give him his coffee, or he would come and give me the tea because I'm in a session. Those things were very important, very essential. And I would keep out the clothes for my son so that, you know, I don't disturb them when I have to go out early. Or I'll keep, for example, salt. I mean, we have our saltwater bath. So to keep the salt ready for Amit, so when he comes in, he's not going to be hassled and looking for it because he's going to take care of our son. So those kind of things really made a big difference. And then he went all out baking. And so there was cakes and blondies and other things that were made. And, you know, we enjoyed it. I remember my son had fever, very high fever that day. And he wouldn't sleep till dad made the cake and brought it. And I told him it's going to take time because it was going to be ready only after dinner. He stayed till 10:30 in the night because he wanted to eat that cake. And, you know, when you make it with love, that is something else to taste, right? And so So I agree, yes. I'm not saying that things are absolutely smooth, but they are definitely far better. But there were ups and downs with this closeness, which caused a lot more friction. But it is still love and the act of, like you said, kindness, where you're still there for them, regardless of what happened a few seconds ago or minutes ago. That made a difference. Yes. I'm not a saint yet. I still get very angry.
I know. It's like, I think most of us have learned some very hard lessons.
Yes.
And there has been a lot of pressure that has come on to a lot of people, especially handling, you know, relationships, handling work, work from home suddenly turned into work all day. There were no barriers. Yeah. So there was so much stress. And at one point, I remember thanking God I had techniques of pranic healing to help me out. Because, you know, self-healing is there. Then there was the meditation on twin hearts. So even if, let's say, you had an altercation or an argument, you know, after that, you practice the forgiveness technique, you do the twin hearts, and it just changes a lot of things. So we had people writing in saying that the meditation has been a savior. The meditation on twin hearts has really been a savior for most of them. Otherwise, everyone would just exploded, and there would be, and we're just so lucky just being able to handle this and keep our sanity and still laugh through the whole thing. Because I think 10 years from now, we'll just be like, oh my God, did you remember? I learned how to cook at that point. So
yes, that's with you, Mekhla. That's true. I started baking. Right. But I agree with you. I have been doing the twin hearts every evening at 6 o'clock. And there have been people who said, you know, thanks for this. Because one is you were locked in. There was no one you could contact. So just that evening coming together and meditating made a big difference to connect to another human being and to do something that was through the meditation, which is also the meditation of peace, to do service. Again, the act of kindness to the entire humanity. And initially, it was like that. But for me, in between, I also started to realize I'm doing all this meditation and I'm not being as loving as I should be. And you know, you go through that phase and then you work through that phase and you come out. And hopefully, we're all going to become only better. Yes, it is good to recognize those limitations that we have. And we're lucky, like you rightly said, we have tools to take care of it. And that's what I think I've been doing. And sometimes it's a little annoying because you feel you're not moving too far. And then after 3-4 weeks, you realize, oops, I've actually made that jump. I have become better. Yeah. But yeah, still a long way off, but definitely going the right direction as far as I'm looking at myself, at least.
Yeah, I think hopefully we're moving and all moving.
Yes, all of us moving ahead.
Not backwards.
It feels like that sometimes. Yeah. But remember, Master Cho used to say that, you know, people on the spiritual path tend to be very tough on themselves. And so when you make a mistake, I've done that, you know, especially because I was home. If I said something to my son or to my husband, I would keep thinking about it and like, you know, that wasn't really nice. How can I do that? Blah, blah, blah. So, you know, you go on repeating it. And then somewhere someone says it in a session or something and says, be aware that this is something that we all do. You repeat and then you start hitting yourself. You need to be careful not to repeat that and come out of it. And so that is something I've been able to come out and not repeat and say, okay, I made a mistake. I need to learn from it. Move on. Stop drowning in it.
So that's really good because a lot of people forget, you know, the least glamorous part of the whole spiritual path is the fact that, you know, you have to sit and really do the hard work on yourself and be very unflinching and say, I was not truthful here or I was not loving here. So it's not only just meditation, it's an all-rounded development. So, you know, at the end of this whole thing, if people are running away from you, that's not a good sign that your spiritual practice is going really well.
That's true. I agree. If that is happening, then there's definitely reason for you to reflect even more. But I think that reflection is very important because you see, we're talking about the act of kindness and I have spoken about it with reference to others, but kindness also means kindness to yourself. And so when you are loving and kind with yourself, it is very, very important because that loving kindness, my son just gave me a flying kiss. So it does make a big difference because if you love yourself, then it becomes easier to love others. But when you're very tough on yourself, you become tough on others as well. And that is something we all need to work on. Yeah?
True. The loving kindness, the kindness part to ourselves is sorely missing sometimes, because, and especially in this day and age when everybody is on social media, everybody's putting up pictures and what they have, you know, it's like you want to see a very, very nice, glamorized picture of yourself. You look on to different social media things. So nobody shows the tough stuff. But all of us have gone through times where we've been super critical with ourselves. Maybe with the way we look, the amount we earn, all these things. And this was one of the questions that we were going to talk about also, that how do you actually stop yourself from thinking like that? Sumi, are there any tips that you know, you've used to stop beating yourself up about it? Like the forgiveness or what, you know, just...
Correct. So I think one of the ways which we need to remember, for me at least, this is from Master's teachings, is, and I realized this personally, is that, you know, even though I was doing Twin Hearts very regularly, but if I've had a scrap with my husband or I've been upset about what I did to my son, I'm not going to be doing that meditation effectively. And so one of the things for me is to learn to forgive. And so when you forgive yourself for what you did, or you forgive the other person for what they said, or maybe even did, then only then will you have peace within. Only then will you be able to then allow that love to come out. Only when that love comes out, will it then manifest as kindness. Otherwise, if we are bitter about what someone said or did to you, and you carry that bitterness and hate within you, only that will fester. And I remember Master Chö would say, what you meditate on, you become. And I realized that was what was happening sometimes. You know, I start thinking about why this person was doing this to me and how can he or she do this to me? And then I go on and on and on. And I realize, you know what? I am doing exactly what I tell people not to do. I better stop. And that awareness is one of the things that helped me. The second is forgiveness. Those two things really helped me to recognize, you know what? That person is going through his or her own problems. Allow them to grow out of that. But thinking about them and hurting yourself doesn't help you.
So if you have someone who's like super unkind all the time, okay? So all of us have had that one person who's been unkind or has said things which are not very nice.
Yeah.
How do you deal with those people?
Let me tell you what Master Chö told me to do. There was this person I had to interact with probably on a regular basis. And he was very aware of the relationship between that person and I. And I remember it was a restaurant and I was seated. I think I was walking out to do something and Master Chö was walking by that table. And then he said, Sumi, this is what I want you to do. I want you to be aware of your heart and your crown and bless the person with gold and pink every day for 21 days. Yes. And so I started. It was very difficult because, you know, internally my head is like, I've never been bad to this person. Why is this person being so mean and rude and difficult with me? So then I said, okay, let's just do what Master Chö is doing. And so I would start to bless. And initially my hands would hurt, you know, and I had to literally kind of flick and then continue. But after 21 days, and then I said, okay, let's give it a rest, as Master Chö said. And then there was a change in this person, which did not happen because I knew the person for how long then? Maybe 5 years plus. Yes. And it's been like that all through. And then suddenly there's been a change. Until date, that change is still there. And so just blessing the person with love from your heart and of course from the crown transforms the other. Yes. Whether it's a person with whom you have to work, whether it's with someone you have to live, whether it's someone you have to meet. Yes. Maybe not necessarily work, but you have to meet them for whatever reason. Use this. It really made a big difference in my life. And I still use it with other people, especially when I realize suddenly people are changing towards me. I remember, hey, Master Chö said this, bless people, because what you give will come back to you. That's basically it, right? That's the law of science. That's the law of spirituality. What you sow, you reap. Yes. It's like the echo. What you send out will come back to you. And then it comes back many, many times.
No, I totally agree with you, because I remember as a newbie, when I just learned pranic healing, and I had this, you know, I had this really good job, actually. Like it was, I still have a really good job, but at that point I had a really good job as well. The only slight snag was that my boss was very rude. he was, I don't think he meant to be that way. He was just very harsh and rude towards everyone, really harsh and rude. So everyone used to kind of give him a wide berth, but I couldn't avoid him because, you know, he was the head of the corporation and I was reporting it to him directly. And I remember thinking, now what? And then after Twin Hearts, every day I used to sit and I used to project so much love, so much peace. So for 3 months, all I did was that. And I remember after 3 months he comes and he's super nice to me, like very accommodating, very nice. And I said, really, that's amazing. So then I went to the people around and I said, he's changed. He's really nice. They're like, what are you talking about? Because he was still rude to everybody else. So, you know, some people are there just to show, you know, to make you change and make, you know, I was stuck onto the fact that he's just a rude person. But, right. And I was returning the rudeness with rudeness in my head. I was not saying it, but the thoughts mattered, right? Because sometimes we're like super sweet to somebody, to their face, but you're kind of like, you know, you get super critical in your head all the time, but that's also sending out energy to that person. So yes. How is a relationship ever going to be better? So after that, I saw the power of the Twin Hearts and I was just like, that's amazing. And then I've been using it in, you know, at work quite a bit. So my next question to you is, a lot of us, you know, at points, the ones who are supposed to be very kind people, they, you know, what's the difference between being kind and being a pushover? Because sometimes kind people get taken for granted. So that's the, you know, they get hurt once or twice and then you say, I'm never going to be kind again. Yeah. Right? So how does, you know, you could expand on
that? I think I've said that myself. You know, I'm never going to do this. but I think one is to recognize that if you're a very kind and loving person, people can take you for a ride. So you need to learn to also love yourself and stand up for yourself. There are times, yes, in certain situations, I realize the best thing is to just keep quiet because whatever you say is not going to get done. And then wait for the right time. There is a time that there will be that space for you to be able to express yourself. At other times, you have to stand up and say that, hey, you know what? What was said or done or sent to me was not pleasant. Yes, and most people are stunned because they don't expect you to stand up for yourself. But sometimes our lesson is to stand up for ourselves. Yes, and the third is when you look at situations where people are difficult, sometimes you're in a position because of who you are in the organization to actually help correct other people. So your kindness is not just yourself, but to also see to it that other people are taken care of. So if in the organization you realize that one person is constantly bullying the other, in whichever way, then you could step in a nice way to see to it that both of them work towards becoming more cordial with each other, at least, right? So one is for yourself, definitely stand up, kindness towards others. And in certain situations, sometimes silence is required.
It's interesting when you talked about silence, because at points, you know, some people are silent, but they're boiling inside. You know, they're really boiling inside. And the kinder way to do it is actually express your feelings in a nice way. And the kind way to say is that, you know, what you did to me hurt.
Yes.
Instead of holding it against the person, because the energy of getting angry or upset is still in your system. So it will affect you at some point. So the manner in how you speak to the person after, and it to avoid a complete explosion later on, because these things add up. So if you just keep quiet, and you're boiling inside, and that's why I think that the pranic healing, the self-healing comes out. We were talking about that, right? Like right. It's difficult to be kind when you're in pain. I remember, you know, we were discussing this just a little earlier, and we said that, you know, with the healing technique, you can actually remove the pain and at least address the problem in a proper way, right? And, you know, what advice do you have for people who are in, you know, a very competitive line of work? Because sometimes, and I was talking to my sister about this, I said, you know, what do you feel about this topic? And she goes, how do I be kind in a company or, you know, at work where at points it's very, very competitive and kindness is somehow you know, everyone's pushing, like, you know, so how does one remain kind in that atmosphere?
I think in many situations, like you're saying, it's usually looked down upon. If you have that quality, you're going to get, like you said, trampled all over. And so for me, in those situations where life is competitive, the world out there is competitive, when you need to express yourself, right, Master would always say you need to have wisdom or intelligence and love. So when you want to express yourself, you use the energy that comes out from what you call the will center, which is the higher will center, which pranic healers we know as Agnya center, not the solar plexus. When it comes out of the solar plexus is when you and I get caught and then it blows out, right? But there are times we have to correct our juniors. We have to work with them. You need to be firm. Firmness comes from here and the heart. And that's the combination that you need. You need the heart and you need the firmness of the Agnya. Even with little kids, they know when it comes from your solar plexus. When you get emotional, they know. And they know they've hooked you and they've got you. So even with little ones, forget the colleagues that you're working with at work. Even the little ones recognize that. Whether you're a teacher, whether you're a mother, whether you're an aunt, they know you are the one to get it from because you get emotional and they've got you. But if you work from this center, the will center and your heart, that's when you are still being kind because you need to help that person change. Yes, if they've made an error, if they need to improve themselves, you know how to give it to them. And Master used to tell us, he says, when you want to correct someone, you can't just talk about their mistakes. You need to first emphasize the good in them, right? So for example, you know, your reporting format is really good. All the information is here. However, in this part, I need you to change, right? You need to balance it because otherwise, he says, you become narrowed down to seeing, like taking a microscope and looking at only the qualities that are not so good. And that's something we all do. Even I do that, especially when I get upset with someone, then I only start seeing the negative in them, right? And if it's your colleague, oh my God, we have to be careful. And that's why constantly I have to remember, even in my head, you know what? She's good at this. He's good at this. If I don't do that, I will go down the same hole and that's difficult. Yes, we have to all work. Strangely, this lifetime is for all of us to work in groups.
I'm glad you brought that up because the criticism aspect, but I'm a Virgo, by the way, I can spot a mistake a mile away. Like, right. I don't know all Virgos, but this is just me. And you know, you can spot it and you're just like, should I say something? Is that too impolite to say something? And then, you know, you tie yourself up in knots because you know it's wrong. So, you know, how do you criticize something without hurting somebody? That has been a big lesson. I think a lot of us have learned because
yes,
interacting with so many people. So, and especially when you've been meditating for a long time, the energy that comes out, you know, if it's too strong, the person tends to crumble or you don't want to destroy someone's self-confidence also. So I think the biggest problem a lot of us, even at home, is we're so quick to find out or say, you did this wrong, you did this wrong, you did this wrong. But the balancing part of it, like, I love you so much, that kind of lags behind. So, you know, and interestingly enough, the research also showed is that constant criticism in a relationship is the one that destroys it.
Yeah.
So if you keep nagging somebody again and again, you're really... So the other question is now, how do you nag someone or get them to change? Because you still have to set it right. So how would you suggest that, Sumi?
Well, one is, I know you can never change anybody but yourself. But the energy that you send to them in your thoughts, yes, in the words that you use and the actions that you, and the behavior that you have towards them is the one that will change them, which basically means, when you send out positive vibes towards them, there's a transformation in that person because you are being positive about them and what you're sending is positive and you're allowing that positivity in them to kind of emerge. However, when we are upset with them and like you said, you know, you also did this, you know, you did this to me as well, then you are pointing towards their negative and you are energizing their negative. And you start this with children. If you want to correct them, you need to talk to them about the good that they're doing and then help them change. But if you only constantly correct them, it has happened to me as well. And they'll say, you are always correcting me. You know, you always say this to me. And that's when you realize, oh my God, I'm not balancing it again. And
so kindness in action, kindness in words, and kindness in thoughts.
Yes, very important. Yes, thoughts, words, and of course, in action as well. And if we can do that, then your relationship, and you know, the person you stay closest to is probably your spouse and your child. And so we have to be most careful about the thoughts we create, because sometimes you don't want to express it. You're so mad at them. Your thoughts that you send out are like bullets.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it can explode in them. And then you wonder why it's you're fighting again the next day, and you're upset the next day again, because what we've been sending. And so we have to be very careful about that. I'm still learning. I'm still working on that. But yes, that is something that I would say we need to be aware of. I catch myself sometimes with my thoughts, especially when I start to get upset or I dislike a person for whatever reason. I need to catch myself and say, you know what, Sumi, that's enough. You think that way, yes, but this person has also got this, and let it be. You know, whether we correct people or whether we feel we need to take revenge, great beings above keep all the records accurately. And so whatever you do, whatever another person does to you, will go back to them. Whatever we've done to someone will come back to us. So whether you do something about it or not, that balance has to happen. Yes. And so to make your life better, because we never know what we actually did to others before. So knowing that, I would always say, if this person is doing something to me, there's a reason why this is happening to me. This is because I sowed these seeds in my past, and this is happening to me right now. And so one of the easiest way is to forgive. It's easier said than done, but that is one. The second is to send love to that person. Yes, and then accept that person for who they are. You know, there is a difficult person. Do whatever you can. If they still don't change well, a scorpion will always bite.
That is true. But it's really amazing that you said that, you know, what you, by the fruit, you shall know the seed. So the good part is that kindness is not static. Like, you know, if you're not a kind person, and that is also okay, right? That if you're not a kind person, you can always improve. That it's like a muscle. The more you act it out, and the more other people also see acts of kindness, they also tend to act kinder. So it's a really beautiful way of living that, you know, you do something good for someone, someone sees you do it and also is inspired by you to do something as well. So it's so on World Kindness Day, I think all of us should really, really think about how we behave, and not just act, but also what's in our thoughts. Because I think most people think that karma does not associate with your thoughts and things like that. It's only physical. You're like, no, what? Everything you do is recorded, right?
Yes.
So a lot of people will be like, oh God, I'm being watched.
Right. So, you know, you think no one can hear your thoughts, but they can, right? We think when we think so about our loved ones, our boss, our teammates, no one knows, they do. And that will be recorded. And if it's with your own, for example, your blood relative, like your own sibling, I've known people who've had issues from the time they were little girls till now, you know. There are people who have issues with their own father, their own mother. Yes, it doesn't mean that it's only going to happen, you know, most people say in-laws. I don't think it's always with in-laws. It could be with your own blood relative. Yes, and this is because of certain reasons why you and he or you and she are destined to be together to learn lessons. Sadly, they are the toughest lesson, like in school. I would always tell people it's like going to earth school. And if you don't like maths, that's your maths teacher. If you did not like science, then that person is your science lesson. You have to learn the lesson to move on. And they present themselves in your life to make you better, actually, to improve you. But when you're going through it, it's very tough.
So before we open the floor out for some questions, how can we increase kindness in our lives? Like, kindness begets kindness, right? So how, you know, your top few thoughts on how to increase kindness, something that all of us can do every day, what would you say?
keeping in mind the festive season as well, right? It's light. And so light and love, if we can remember that we can share this with our thoughts, which is actually the toughest. If you can every morning, with just the loved ones around you, yes, in your home, you can just think of one good thing about them before you start, before you get off that bed, while you lie down there, right? Think about one good thing about everyone in that house. People who help you, your driver, your nanny, your cook, the people who help you clean, or include all of them, your gardener, whoever you have, makes a big difference because you're starting your day by sending positive vibrations, positive vibes. Your day can only get better.
So I would like to end with something that Shakespeare said, actually. So I'm just going to read it out. And Shakespeare said, "My bounty is as boundless as the sea. My love is deep. The more I give thee, the more I have. For both are infinite." So kindness is like that as well. The same thing applies for kindness. The more you give it, the more you shall have kindness in your life. So hopefully, you know, everybody really, really understood what you were trying to say. I hope that this has been helpful for everyone. And for everyone especially who is having a difficult time and thinks that nobody's listening to them. I have been so kind, but you know, nobody's kind to me. They will be good to you. They will be kind to you. Your time will come. Time will come. So it's just a matter of time for the kindness to come back. So whoever is feeling low, whoever is feeling that, you know, I've had a difficult time, there's always kindness, and God's kindness is boundless. So on that note, Sumi, we will throw open some questions.
Sure.
So I'm looking. They say, so I'm looking at this one. It says, Dikshita has this question. They say bad things happen to good people. We've often seen the kind people suffer. Do you still recommend kindness?
Good one. Yes, it does seem like that. So you've got to remember that, like I mentioned earlier, we do not know what this kind person did before to go through this difficult time again. So if you look at the yin and yang symbol, that's symbolic of that. So even though you have the white portion, you still have a black dot in it. And even in the black portion, you have a white dot. So even the worst person still has something good in them. And even the kindest person has something that's not so good in them. And the same thing happens with our lives. If you find that this person has been so loving and kind, how come their life is so difficult? They have all these issues. It's what they have sown in their past that is now bearing fruit in their present time. Yes, and they will have to go through that. And once they go through that, they will come out of it better.
Okay, so this also answers somebody else's question. Does a kind person have to suffer due to past life?
Well, we have to pay for everything that we have thought, said, and done, right? And so it's like accounts. You have to balance it out. And life will throw different things at you. And you can, you can try and neutralize it by using the golden rule, which basically is very simple. It just says, what you want others to do to you, you do to others. And what you do not want others to do to you, do not do to others. That's it. It's as simple as that. So if you can start working on that now, at least what you are planting today will bear better fruits in your future. Yes. And so those kind people, as they continue to remain kind and loving despite their difficulties, are then now presently planting the right seeds to have a better life in their future.
So I remember when someone used to be not so nice to me, and I look at them and I'll say, You're just practice. You are not going to get me down. You're just practice. Then I'll be like, okay, you know, let's see how this goes. So, you know, there's a certain sort of commitment when it comes down to kindness. You choose who you are, right? You choose who you are, because if you are not kind, you're not being true to yourself either. That will just lead you to more unhappiness. So I'm looking at Charmi's question. Even practicing kindness to a certain degree with parents, blood related, still on many levels, you don't gel up much, and I'm the one to suffer most times because my siblings will always be in a bad position and bad with mom and dad. What more can be done? So,
so it's like five fingers against you. So yes, I can imagine the friction being even more difficult for you to deal with. You're like the odd one out there. And so it means your lesson to forgive and be loving and kind requires a PhD. And a PhD is not easy. Yes, it takes a lot more effort and strength to complete a PhD compared to going through just school, correct? And so, yes, why have you taken a PhD this lifetime? I don't know, but you have. And that is difficulty. I'm not going to say no. But if that's the lesson you and I have to learn, then that's what we will learn.
So Parvati writes,
all right.
Had an unpleasant experience in the past with a person. If an opportunity to help them in the future arises, should we wait for them to approach or extend our help voluntarily?
I think I would go back to what Mekhla said. It's a choice that you want to take at that point to decide who you want to be. Do you want to be the person who still goes out to help them? Or will you say, you know what, let him or her ask me, then I'll go and help. Which means you actually want to help. That's basically the end thing. You actually want to help. So if you want to help, go and help. Because if they shut their door, it's like this. It's like the sun shines. Now, if you don't like the sun and you go in the shade, then that's your problem. But the sun will always shine. So it's like that. You are kind, loving. You're there to help. You help. If they don't want your help, that's their problem, not yours.
So interestingly, Lata writes, won't it be artificial if I know how much I hate that person? To bless it sounds hollow. So,
true, I know. When you go down, should I bless you or should I go towards the neck? No. Blessing. You know why? Because you've got to remember that this hate and anger that you have with this person is got to do with something that you have sown. Maybe the relationship with this is with the same person or something that you did with someone else that is manifesting now through this person. And so if it is time for you to end your life and you look back, would it make sense to actually have hated someone and gone away from this earth? Or would you prefer to have had peace within you when you left, right? And so for me, it is peace. I remember reading, maybe it was Chicken Soup for the Soul in those days. I mean, you know, when it was a big hit, I think there was a story like that. And it said, if you were going to die next week, you know, what would you do? And I realized if that was the case, then I would want to forgive and, you know, make good with all persons around me, friends, family, others, as much as I can. Because I want to go out of this world free and happy and peaceful. So that's why I would think of doing that, definitely.
Yeah, because there was a session that I'd taken once and we were talking about forgiveness and someone says, but how do I forgive it? I know what it is. I said, otherwise, you know, it eats you up. So the lady comes to me after and she goes, I know what you mean. It's eating me up inside. The hatred is eating me up. So I said, okay. So I said, you must do the forgiveness. No, I can't. It's eating me up. So I said, you know, I mean, it's up to you, right? If you want to hold on to something that is eating you up, that is also your choice. And then the lady goes, but it's my husband. So then I was like, oh, that's a whole new way to go. But whether it's someone who's close to you or someone from far, usually it's people who are close to us who hurt us the most, right?
Yes, agreed.
So that's a higher level of forgiveness that you have to, you know, because you love someone and then they do something that hurts you and then you really hold on to them. So in the end, it's like personal choice. You know, you decide what is the energy that you want to live with. The hatred inside, which will make you sick physically. It will cause pain and resentment in your life. Or do you want to just say, okay, fine. This person has made mistakes. I've made mistakes also. And this person is here because of karma. So that's the person. So Lata, you will have to get over the fact that you really, really dislike this person.
You know, one of the things that I remember also, again, going back to our teacher, he says that we're all evolving and this is why we're all here. And the process of evolution implies time, process, and mistakes. And I think that's one thing for me to remember constantly, that you and I will make mistakes. And so if we can give ourselves permission to make mistakes, then we will give other people also permission to make mistakes, which means that you and I are not perfect. And if you're expecting a perfect spouse, which sometimes we all do, it's not going to happen, yes? Because you are not perfect to start with, right? If we were perfect, we wouldn't be here, yes? And so when we recognize and accept that person with their imperfections, that's when your days will become better. I'm not saying it's going to be perfect again. It cannot be perfect. But your life is going to be better because you realize, you know what? That's how he or she is. But I love the person nevertheless. With your little baby, when she or he bites you, scratches you, you get upset for a moment. But then because of your love, you go back and hug that same little child, right? And they hug you back. It's love that helps you overcome these difficulties.
It's love that heals. So
yes.
So which is why coming back to pranic healing, loving kindness is loving kindness in action. That is love.
Yes.
So the ones who have not done pranic healing so far, when the classes open up, you need to run to class and learn how to really, really love because you're doing something for somebody. So somebody, so Radhika asked, sometimes being kind drains out, feeling like giving in so much, but don't receive so much. How do I cope up with the situation? So I'm assuming she feels that she's given a lot, but she's feeling drained because she's given too much. How do I cope with this situation?
Well, one of the things I would ask you, Radhika, is whether you love yourself. Giving love to others is one thing. It's a beautiful act. But you need to also love yourself because if you don't love yourself and you constantly give, you are going to drain yourself out. But if you love yourself and love another, then it is easy because you have taken care of yourself. And then when you give to others, you will never get drained. So that would be my question to you.
So Komal says that I have seen that kind people are taken advantage of. Komal, we just talked about it. You know, it's like being kind and being taken advantage of or being a pushover. We actually spoke about this, but you don't want to be taken advantage of. How do I balance the two? I think Sumi answered that question earlier about, you know, balancing using which chakra. So at points you use the heart and you also use the will center, right? So, you'll have to figure out how to balance it out. So after helping, Jude also says, after helping out people, why do we still face problems in life? How do we overcome it? So I think that will probably be the last one because we're going to go into Twin Hearts very soon. So maybe two more questions more. So.
All right. So this might be a little different from what I've been talking about earlier. So it's like this, you know, the seeds that we have all planted in the past, we're not too sure how many of those are lemon seeds, bitter gourd seeds. Yes. And so what is then bearing fruit at this present moment depends on what we have. Yes. If you've just planted one watermelon, you might get it only during the summer. The rest of the year, you will have to deal with sour lemon and bitter gourd. Right. So it's something like that. So it really, we do not know what we have planted. Yes, but you have the opportunity to plant the right seeds today. And so emphasize on that so your future can be better. And yes, the present may not be may be difficult for you at this point, but remember we have the future in our hands.
So someone said, what's the will center, the Ajna center, which Sumi spoke about earlier. So it's always a balance, right? Not solar plexus, but the solar plexus, as she said, most of us have very big solar plexuses. And that really is, that's the one that causes you the pain, actually. It just goes haywire. You give yourself more pain, more, you know, hurt. So anyway.
And I wouldn't say only Agnya, and that's why I specifically mentioned heart, because if you are only Agnya, you're so willful that you're like a bull. You know, you would just go through heading to wherever you have to, your goal, your target. And in the process, you might hurt people on the way. Because you don't have a heart, you can't see that. You don't notice you've hurt other people. And that's why you need both. You need a heart and a will to push through, get work done, but at the same time being sensitive and taking care of the needs and the requirements of others. Yeah. Okay.
So someone says, Minu says, when we send negative thoughts to a loved one, by being aware of it and erasing it and, you know, can the negative impact of that thought be minimized? Also by showing loving kindness to that person. So Meenu sounds a little worried that she's basically gone and basically thought some not so nice things and like, you know, saying, oh, I shouldn't have thought that way, which is a good, which is a, it's a good thing actually that you understand that you've done that, but
So I think when you do have thoughts about others, it's good to know that you're aware that you've said that. That's awareness is the first step to change. But when you, for example, erase, that's one thing to try and work on yourself. So you're erasing that pattern in you, and then you're sending loving kindness to that person. So one is the erasing is to erase your own pattern. So you come up with a new pattern. But don't forget, after erasing, you need to replace it with a good pattern. How do you want to be towards this person in the future? And the second is sending loving kindness is good. But I think the most important part is to try and figure out how do you want to be in the future towards him or her, the person that you've been sending these thoughts to. You need to change that pattern, right? So once you erase it, you need to replace it with the right pattern.
So the good part is with pranic healing, and for everybody who's not done pranic healing and who has watched this, there are ways to remove these negative thoughts and programs from your system with pranic healing. So once you come into the school, you will understand it. So with that, we're going to kind of close the question and answer session right now, because we're going to go into the Twin Hearts meditation. Now, everyone who's going to watch this on YouTube or, you know, whatever platform later, if you haven't done Twin Hearts meditation, it is one of the most powerful, loving meditations that you can encounter. So everything that we have been talking about, the kindness that needs to increase, you know, if you do the Twin Hearts meditation every day, you will see a big, big change in, you know, in love and kindness towards yourself and towards your family. So it is literally magical. So the details about the meditation will be put up on the post with the video whenever it is posted. So make sure that you contact, you know, World Pranic Healing for that, and the details will be given. For the ones who are watching right now live, we are going to do the Twin Hearts meditation right now. And Sumi, we, you know, since so many people have difficult people, maybe after the meditation, we can, you know, direct some loving energy towards everyone who's hurt us. I think a lot of people would appreciate that, especially the one who really dislikes somebody.
Yes. So Mekla, maybe we can start off with a short forgiveness prayer right now, so you ease your disturbance and hurt and pain, so you may be more peaceful when you start off with a meditation. Would you like that?
That, I think, would be lovely. And, you know, just a big thank you for you to just sorting a lot of people's, you know, thoughts out right now, because clearly, love is something that all of us need to learn in this life.
Yes.
Loving kindness, and however rich you are, however, whatever you might have, if you don't have love and kindness in your life, it's a very dry, painful thing. So a big thank you to you for helping us through all of this and being here and spending Dhanteras with us. So. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mekla, also, because I think without you, this wouldn't be possible as well. Mekla is the managing trustee of the Pranic Healing Foundation back there in South Mumbai. She's been a friend for a very, very long time. I still remember seeing her coming for all these classes. She'll fly to different parts of India just to complete all the various courses of Grandmaster. And so thank you also for taking time to be with all of us and helping us through this entire process. Yeah. Thank you, Mekla.
Thank you so much. And a big thank you to the team. And of course, a big thank you to all the participants right now. So we are going to do the forgiveness right now with Sumi. So settle down. And, you know, if you still have more questions, maybe if you write in or maybe later on when the video comes up and you put your question down in the comments, maybe we'll be able to help you out there. It's just there is a lack of time where we can sit and answer everyone's question. But you know, we send a lot of love and kindness to you as well. So, and in healing. So hopefully you enjoyed this session. So settle down. We're going to do the forgiveness and the Twin Hearts right now. And you guys have been a great audience. So
yes, thank you so much for all joining us today. Kindly close your eyes, connect onto your palate. Inhale and exhale. Now I'd like you to remember the person who has caused pain, hurt in your life. And also remember the person you have caused pain, hurt in your life. Again, another person that you have caused hurt and pain, this is the second person. I'd like you to also remember someone who has hurt you, the second person, made your life difficult. And the third one, the one you have hurt, and the one who has hurt you. Now, interestingly, you have three names in each side. You'll notice that some of them are the same. So the person who hurts you is also the person you hurt. Yes? So I'd like you to visualize the three persons in front of you. Raise your hand at chest level. I'd like you to mentally follow me with a prayer. We're going to repeat it three times. We're all children of God. We're all evolving. Evolution implies time, process, and mistakes. And so I ask you to forgive me for what I've done and not done, for what I've said and not said. And I forgive you for what you have done and not done, for what you have said and not said. In forgiving you, I shall be forgiven. This is the divine law. May we be blessed with love and peace and understanding, with harmony, with forgiveness, with tolerance, with reconciliation, with goodwill and the will to do good. May we be blessed with all that God thinks we need. So be it. We'll repeat it two more times. We're all children of God. We're all evolving. Evolution implies time, process, and mistakes. I ask you to forgive me for what I have done and not done, for what I have said and not said. And I forgive you for what you have done and not done, for what you have said and not said. In forgiving you, I shall be forgiven. May we be blessed with love and peace and all that God thinks is best for us. So be it. We're all children of God. We're all evolving. Evolution implies time, process, and mistakes. So I ask you to forgive me for what I have done and not done, for what I've said and not said. And I forgive you for what you've done and not done, for what you've said and not said. In forgiving you, I shall be forgiven. This is the divine law. May we be blessed with love and peace and understanding and harmony, with forgiveness and tolerance, with reconciliation, with goodwill, the will to do good. May we be blessed with all that God thinks is best for us. So be it, so be it, so be it. Peace be with you. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti Om. Mentally say, cut all those experiences with those people, cut, cut. Be aware of your heart, be aware of your crown. Visualize golden pinkish energy going towards these persons. Immerse them in this golden pinkish energy. Every part is filled with golden pinkish energy. If you like, you may say Atma Namaste. I salute the divinity in you. God's love and peace be with me. God's love and peace be with you. You may slowly place your hands on your lap. Keep your eyes closed. Be aware of your inner state as we move into the meditation on twin hearts for peace and illumination. Atma Namaste to all of you. Thank you for being with us.
Continue to keep your eyes closed. We will start with a meditation. Close your eyes and put your hands in position. Visualizing the earth in front of you. May every person, every being globally be blessed with greater light and love during this festive season. May the light of wisdom, of knowledge, of discernment, of right decision enter the minds of every person, every being. May your love enter our hearts, blessing us with greater acts of kindness in our thoughts, words, and action to ourselves and others. Give us the inner strength and power to overcome all our limitations and weaknesses, our misunderstandings and difficulties, and to help manifest who we truly are. By the will and power of God, may the present world pandemic, the COVID-19, the related egregores globally, be contained and be disintegrated right now, transformed and transmuted into higher vibrations. May your healing energy descend on earth. Please remember the areas that are affected, maybe even the place that you're staying. Visualize this energy healing people, enhancing the herd immunity of the entire globe. Allow these energies to go into your homes, into every person, every being at home. Inhale the blessings. Exhale, spread the energy to your entire being to enhance your immune and defense system, making your musculoskeletal system, your circulatory system, your respiratory system, lymphatic system, and your brain strong and healthy, resistant towards any invasion. Please bless the entire globe, blessing them with the imbalance that is causing problems economically, politically, border issues, natural calamities affecting the lives of many, physical health, psychological health affecting families, friends, relationships. May your healing energy continue to heal every person, every being. May we be instrumental in bringing about greater balance and harmony through the entire globe. May your energies go up, high up to the mountain, into the sky, deep into the ocean, to the forest, to the desert, to the snow, to every being, every creature, allowing us to restore peace. Thank you for accepting us as humble instruments to do your work. With thanks and in full faith, so be it. Please continue to bless others who ask you to pray for them, those going through a difficult time. Your businesses, your professions, your careers with greater prosperity and abundance, greater harmony, greater one-pointedness, greater loyalty. Bless also every person, every being, all through the entire globe, even those we do not know. May all their dreams, wishes manifest rapidly and properly as per the will of God. Thank you. So be it, so be it, so it is. You may slowly open your eyes with a smile. Please massage yourself. Yes, you need to really massage yourself and do more blessings. There is a lot of energy that's coming down. And lastly, again, at this festive time, may the love and light in me, yes, honor the love and light in you, and may it continue to spread from each one of us in all directions, above and below, to bring about change, happiness, and joy in your lives. Thank you, everybody, for being with us today. Atma Namaste.
Atma Namaste. To everyone who has joined us, a big thank you, and a big thank you to World Pranic Healing, which has arranged this whole event. A big thank you to everyone behind the scenes who put up everything so flawlessly. Of course, a big thank you to Sumi, and of course to all of you.
Hey, Claire.
To all of you for being here, and wish everyone a fantastic Diwali. Hopefully everything will be going wonderfully for you Diwali onwards, and lots of love from all of us. And just please make sure that you follow the Facebook and the Instagram accounts of all World Pranic Healing accounts on social media.
Yes.
This video will be up on YouTube as well, so we will be sharing it with you.
Yeah.
Now, there are some questions that, you know, some of you have kind of maybe glossed over, or it hasn't really hit you at that point. So make sure you go over the talk again, and hopefully it will give you inspiration. So a big thank you to all of you who's joined, and of course the team.
Yes. To you. Thank you everyone for joining us. And like she said, happy Diwali and also happy New Year. I think some of you also start the New Year with this. Yes? Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.